Hi everyone. In this video, let us discuss gabapentin versus pregabalin. Gabapentin as well as pregabalin, both of these drugs belong to the same category and they are classified as anti-epileptic agents. Both of these drugs can be used in the treatment of partial onset seizures, but still these two drugs are not equivalent. Gabapentin is available under various brand names, and among them, Neurontin is one of the brand that is well known. Pregabalin is well familiar with its brand name Lyrica. Interestingly, we can find a single word in both of these drug names. We can find the GABA term in both of these drugs. So, gabapentin and pregabalin are the GABA derivatives. This is the structure of GABA, which is a gamma aminobutyric acid. Since both of these drugs are having the GABA incorporated in these structures, these drugs are called as gabapentinoids. Even they are classified as antiepileptics, but they are mainly used to control neuropathic pain. So in the management of neuropathic pain, the gabapentin and pregabalin are the two important drugs, but they are not equivalent. So today in this video, we are going to see what are the similarities and differences between gabapentin and pregabalin. So let us start with the first one, the mode of action. Both gabapentin as well as pregabalin work in a similar way. They can act on the neurons, particularly the excitatory neurons which are storing the glutamate. This is the presynaptic glutamatergic neuron and this is the postsynaptic neuron which is expressed with glutamate receptors like AMPA. Now the release of glutamate is controlled by one of the ion channel, voltage-gated calcium channel. This calcium channel opens based on the voltage within the presynaptic neurons. So when an impulse reaches to the presynaptic neuron, these voltage-gated calcium channels are opened so calcium can enter, which produce depolarization resulting in the release of glutamate. This glutamate can bind to AMPA receptors resulting in postsynaptic excitation. In this way, glutamate produces excitation of the neurons. But when this excitation is uncontrolled and excessive, it may lead to various disorders like epilepsy, or it can produce some neuronal dysfunction resulting in increased nociception leading to neuropathic pain. In such conditions, gabapentin and pregabalin can control this neuronal activity. Here, the voltage-gated calcium channels play an important role in the release of glutamate, which are having an extra pocket, alpha to delta site. Now, gabapentin can bind to this alpha to delta site as well as pregabalin can also bind to the same site. Thereby, they can inhibit the activity of voltage-gated calcium channels. Now, when these channels are not opened, glutamate is not released. So, this reduces the glutamate transmission. Thereby, it can reduce the neuronal excitability. In this way, both gabapentin and pregabalin act in similar way by inhibiting the activity of voltage-gated calcium channels. So this is the first similarity between gabapentin and pregabalin. Even they are having the term GABA in their name, but they are not affecting the GABA transmission. Second one is the rate of absorption. At this point, gabapentin and pregabalin differ. Gabapentin is slowly absorbed through the small intestine, whereas pregabalin is rapidly absorbed. So rate of absorption is somewhat slow in case of gabapentin. Another important thing is that gabapentin shows saturation kinetics. That means when the dose of the gabapentin is increased, the rate of absorption is not proportionally increased. So at higher doses, gabapentin shows less absorption. This is because gabapentin is absorbed by carrier-mediated mechanism. So when all these carriers are saturated, the absorption of gabapentin is reduced. On the other hand, pregabalin is better absorbed, and the absorption of pregabalin is not affected by the food. So at this point, pregabalin shows some advantage because it is having better absorption and it does not show any saturation kinetics. Third one is clinical uses. Gabapentin can be used for the treatment of partial onset seizures. That's why it is classified as anti-epileptic agent. Here it can be used as an adjuvant along with other drugs. But apart from this clinical use, it is mainly used in other conditions like post-herpetic neuralgia, where neuronal pain is produced after any herpes infection that can be treated by gabapentin. Similarly, it can be used for the treatment of neuropathic pain, where excessive neuronal activity increases the nociception. Pregabalin is also used for the same purpose. It can be used for the partial onset seizures, post-herpetic neuralgia, as well as neuropathic pain. Apart from these clinical indications, pregabalin can be used in the management of fibromyalgia. In the conditions like diabetic neuropathy, both gabapentin as well as pregabalin can be used, but pregabalin is more effective in the treatment of diabetic neuropathy. On the other hand, gabapentin can be used for the conditions like restless leg syndrome. This is a condition where a patient is having the desire to move their legs. In such conditions, gabapentin can be used as an off-label purpose. Fourth one is the binding affinity. Both gabapentin and pregabalin act in similar way. They can bind to alpha to delta site of voltage-gated calcium channels. But the binding affinity is somewhat different. Gabapentin can bind to this site, as well as pregabalin can also bind to this site. But pregabalin shows more binding affinity. So because of more affinity, pregabalin can be used at a low dose in controlling neuropathic pain. Fifth one is the doses. Gabapentin is available as a capsule as well as tablet. It can be started initially at a dose of 300 mg per day dose. And the maximum dose can be achievable based on the clinical conditions. It is variable from 1800 mg to 2400 mg per day. It can be given as a divided doses as 3 times a day. Now if we see the pregabalin, it is also available as a capsule or tablet. And the initial dose is variable from 50 to 75 mg based on the clinical indication. And the maximum dose is also variable from 450 mg to 600 mg per day. So we can clearly observe that the dose of pregabalin is somewhat less because this drug is more potent compared with gabapentin. And gabapentin should be given at a high dose because it is somewhat less absorbed compared with pregabalin. Sixth one, side effects. Both gabapentin and pregabalin show similar side effects. They act centrally to produce various side effects like dizziness, drowsiness, somnolence, sleepiness in the people, and they can also produce some blurred vision. All these common side effects can be observed with both gabapentin as well as pregabalin. But few of the side effects are more pronounced with pregabalin. It can produce some dry mouth, peripheral edema, and weight gain. On the other hand, gabapentin can produce some nystagmus, involuntary movements of the eye, and it can also produce some hyperkinesia, some jerky motor movements. So dry mouth is more troublesome with pregabalin, and involuntary movements are more troublesome with gabapentin. Seventh one, analgesic activity. In the treatment of neuropathic pain, which drug shows more analgesic activity? Gabapentin should be used at high dose, whereas pregabalin is used at low dose, so it is having more potency. Because of more potency, pregabalin can show more analgesic activity even at low dose compared with gabapentin. Eighth one is the withdrawal effects. At this point, both gabapentin and pregabalin act in similar way. Both of these drugs are addictive at higher doses and they should not be stopped suddenly because they can produce some withdrawal effects when they are stopped suddenly. Because of withdrawal effects, both gabapentin and pregabalin should not be stopped suddenly. And their dose should be slowly tapered in order to avoid withdrawal effects. So that's all about the similarities and differences between gabapentin and pregabalin. In view of analgesic activity and potency, pregabalin shows more advantages. But in view of side effects, gabapentin is somewhat more tolerated as pregabalin produces some dry mouth, peripheral edema and weight gain as troublesome side effects. So that's all about this gabapentin versus pregabalin. So that's for today. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel, share this video with your friends, post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.